Okay, welcome everyone. Welcome to our workshop, Reframing Our Perspective, a Trauma-Informed Approach to Helping Teens in a Pandemic. We're very happy to welcome people from 5 countries across 2 continents who are with us today as we discuss and review strategies for helping students deal with trauma related to the pandemic. Just a note, we'll be recording this session and you'll also be getting an email from my colleague, Tim Frederick, containing a link to the video recording, any handouts and videos we review, and the PowerPoint presentation deck. So please check your spam folders for this email as it may get stuck there. Okay, so with over 100 people taking part in today's workshop, there are a few housekeeping items we'd like to go over with you. First and foremost, we're still in the process of tinkering with and figuring out Zoom. So please bear with us and with each other throughout the session as we make space for mistakes and any technical difficulties. Okay, so in order to reduce background noise, we've put everyone on mute. You also should note that in the chat box, my colleague Tim will be posting links to some documents that some of which you'll need to have open during the webinar. For instance, right now, Tim is adding a link in the chat box to a document that goes over some of the technical concepts of Zoom in more detail. You won't need to have this open for the session unless, of course, it's helpful to you. And just remember that in order to view these documents, you might have to take Zoom out of full screen by hitting Escape to go to your web browser. Okay, another note, we'll be putting you into breakout rooms twice during today's webinar. You'll have a facilitator in both breakout rooms. And secondly, please keep yourself on mute during the facilitated breakout sessions until you've raised your hand and been called on by your group facilitator. This is to decrease background noise. To raise your hand, just click on the participants button and you'll see an option to raise hand there. Also, please use the chat function during the main session for technical assistance should a problem arise. We have Sam, our tech person, on standby just in case. She has the word tech in front of her name. And finally, again, when going from Zoom to any shared links or other windows, make sure to hit Escape to take Zoom out of full screen mode. Okay, so now that our tech talk is finished, let's take a look at what we'll be going over today. We have a number of experts in the room with us today, and we're going to kick the session off by hearing from one of them, Cecily Mitchell Harper, who will lead us through an overview of trauma, what it is, and what does it mean to be trauma-informed. We'll then be doing 2 group read-alouds of excerpts from 2 different teens' written stories. These breakout room story discussions will be followed by a panel discussion and a review of some resources we have for you. Our objectives in doing this session with you is to first understand trauma, what it means, and what being trauma-informed consists of. Second, we'll learn about 2 adolescents' experiences of dealing with trauma around the pandemic by reading 2 of our teen written stories. And third, we'll discuss methods for helping young people deal positively with trauma and the emotions that go with it. Finally, let's introduce our staff. So my name is Janelle Greco. I'll be one of your hosts today, and I'm the Director of Education here at Youth Communication. With me today is my colleague, Tim Frederick, who will also be helping out. You can also chat Tim if you're having any technical difficulties or issues. Tim is the Senior Director of Education Programs here at Youth Communication. Tim, feel free to say hi.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here.
And with us today is also Cecily Mitchell Harper, who I'll introduce in a little more detail later. She is a Program Evaluation Associate and Trainer for Ramapo for Children. Cecily, if you want to say hi, you can go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much. I appreciate being here.
Awesome. Thanks. We're also happy to be hosting this session with Student Success Network. Today, Kelly Nelson from Student Success Network, I think, is with us. So Kelly, if you want to introduce Student Success Network, you can go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. Happy to be co-facilitating and joining Youth Communication on another of the webinar series. Really quickly, many of you might be familiar with Student Success Network. We are a network of about 70 organizations across the 5 boroughs. We operate on the principle that we serve students better if we learn from each other and you know, co-design solutions to challenges that we're all facing. Our network collectively serves about 250,000 youth, and they bring a range of experiences across the arts, sports, and education, and really many more program areas. So just happy to have youth communication as one of our very active members during this remote pandemic, or this remote reality that we're currently navigating. Just happy to be here. And please reach out if you have any questions. I'll provide email, or Tim can circle, provide your information, and I'll circle back to you. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Kelly. So a little bit about, now that we've heard about Student Success Network, just a little bit about youth communication. We are a nonprofit based in New York City, and we run a teen writing program. Our teens write stories about their lives and about persisting through challenges, and those stories are then published in two magazines, YC Teen and Represent, which is a magazine for and by youth in foster care. We then take those stories and create social emotional learning curricula and professional development sessions using the stories as focal points. So our curricula range from middle and high school SEL to making transitions to career readiness and diversity and advocacy. We currently have a grant to run our girls program, Real as Me. So if your school or organization is interested in partnering with us, you can reply to our follow-up email. And that's a resource for you. We also have additional staff from youth communication with us helping us out today as breakout session facilitators and panelists. They are Betsy Cohen, Keith Hefner, Virginia Witzum, Holly St. Lifer, and Rashiba Stevenson. One of them will be in your breakout room facilitating it as we go along. And finally, just to go over, we have some hopes and expectations for you as participants as we move forward in this session. We'd like for all of you to set a goal to contribute verbally to discussions at least once during the session. There's a lot of experience among our participants today, and we want to hear from you as much as you hear from us so that we can pool our collective knowledge as a group. In order to create the feel of a virtual community, we also ask that, if possible, you please turn on your video cameras in an effort to make this feel a bit more personal. Of course, this isn't required, but if you can turn on your video, it would be greatly appreciated. Once you do that, you can put Zoom in gallery view, which is at the top right-hand corner of the Zoom window. And so when I stop sharing my screen, that should help you see everyone better. And finally, don't forget the chat box. If you don't want to respond verbally, the chat box is a great option for getting our ideas down and sharing them with the group. Okay. So now let's dive into our content for today. I'm going to turn it over to Cecily Mitchell Harper, who will get us started. Cecily is a licensed social worker with a passion and specialty for utilizing research to promote equity and support child-serving institutions. Cecily currently serves as the Program Evaluation Associate at Ramapo for Children and is an adjunct lecturer at NYU's Silver School of Social Work. Cecily received her BA in psychology from Wesleyan University in Connecticut and her MSW from the University of Pennsylvania School of Social Policy and Practice. Additionally, Cecily also provides training, coaching, and consultation services to schools and out-of-school time programs in the areas of social-emotional competency development for staff, creating trauma-informed systems of care, and utilizing a continuous improvement framework to support institutional change. The resources that she shares during her presentation will be included in our follow-up email as well. I'm going to give it over to Cecily Mitchell Harper.
Good afternoon, all. Thank you so much. Thank you, Janelle. And so basically, I'm just going to provide a little introduction, what I want to call Trauma 101, for this presentation. And I'm entitling this "For Such a Time as This: Developing a Trauma-Informed SEL Lens, Social Emotional Learning Lens." This is just a brief presentation, as I said. So welcome to Trauma 101. In this brief lesson, you'll receive foundational knowledge about what trauma is, how can we understand this time through a trauma lens, and the impact of trauma on those who experience it, and the implications this has for us in our respective roles during this time. Next slide. Okay, so first, what is trauma? Trauma is defined as extreme stress brought on by shocking or unexpected circumstances or events that overwhelms a person's ability to cope. So it's two things brought together. There's extreme stress, unexpected circumstances, and it overwhelms a person's natural coping mechanisms such that they're now in a state of trauma or shock. Trauma can be experienced on an individual or collective, communal, or societal level. Now, what we are experiencing right now with the COVID-19 pandemic is what we would call shared trauma. We are all in this COVID-19 storm. However, I want to point out that we are not all in the same boat. We're in the same storm, but the impact of this trauma or this pandemic on us is going to be different depending on prior circumstances and depending on how personally close to this situation that we are. So that's why I just want to point out it is a shared trauma, but then it gets individualized depending on your unique circumstances. Okay, what does trauma do? So trauma can have lasting adverse effects on our functioning, mental, physical, social, emotional, spiritual well-being. So trauma really can impact everything, right? Can impact all of our systems. And trauma threatens our sense of safety and well-being, which can lead to a continuous state of hypervigilance and anxiety, even well after the traumatic experience has passed. I think this quote highlights this best. Trauma violates the familial ideas or expectations about the world of an individual or society, plunging them into a state of extreme confusion and uncertainty. As I mentioned in the beginning and in my previous slide, this can be individual, but also collectively, right? During this time, we have been plunged into a state of extreme confusion and uncertainty, and we're trying to figure out how to move forward and navigate this time, as well as how to help our youth do that through this time. And I just wanna say that if you do want more information specifically about trauma or more information about trauma and COVID-19, my contact information will be provided at the end of this session. So you can absolutely feel free to reach out to me for additional information. Next slide, please. Okay, so what does trauma do? So a little biology lesson to help us understand the impact of trauma, we turn to brain science. So decades of research has revealed exactly what happens to the brain when we experience a traumatic event. A traumatic experience can be triggering well after the initial threat is gone. So even after this pandemic is over and we're back to a more normal, quote, normal life, there's still going to be some lasting impacts that we want to be aware of. And this is what leads to hypervigilance. So for brain science, little biology lesson, as I said, two parts to keep in mind. There's the feeling brain, which we call the amygdala, and there's the thinking brain, which we call the prefrontal cortex. Some of you may have heard those terms. Let me break this down a little bit further. So when we are triggered, we go into our feeling brain. And our thinking brain, the prefrontal cortex, temporarily goes offline, what experts call the amygdala hijack. You've all heard of the terms fight, flight, or freeze. That's the trigger response. That is our brain going into this amygdala feeling brain where we're not able to think rationally, we're not able to make decisions, we're not able to take in information and take risks. So what we need to do is we actually need to de-escalate in order to bring our thinking brain back online, because right now, if we're in our trauma hijack mode, we're offline. Next slide, please. Okay, so to give a little demonstration as to what we're talking about, we have, some experts have modeled this hand model of the brain. So basically it's just looking specifically at what this amygdala hijack is and making it more accessible for those who are not brain scientists. So we're actually going to watch a very brief YouTube video that explains this well.
So what happens to the brain? When we experience trauma, we have a buildup of cortisol. Cortisol is good for us. Say, for example, someone pulls out in front of you while you're driving, you would hit the brake. Uh-oh, I need to stop. But with trauma, living in toxic and chronic stress, the cortisol continues to build up. And our other neurotransmitter, adrenaline, is supposed to soothe us, but it no longer works. So imagine driving with trauma. What happens in the brain? We make bottom-up decision-making. If you're not familiar with Dr. Dan Siegel's hand model of the brain, this is what he shows adults and for kids. So what happens is that you're thinking here. This is your limbic system near your spinal cord. So if you're perceived with a threat, you react. Because why? Here's your amygdala. Everybody say amygdala, okay? Your amygdala are your emotions. And here is your neocortex. So it's supposed to be covered. Because think, when you're perceived with a threat, if someone right now were to walk in here, I would think, and then I would react. Well, kids who've experienced trauma, they just flip their lids. They react. Why? Because they have not developed that, again, that consistency and that connection. So they feel like they're constantly dodging balls at a batting cage. When they come into your schools, that's what they're thinking. That's what they're feeling. So even if you ask them a simple question, like where's your homework, you may get an explosion because that is constantly going on in their bodies. They're trying to be safe. They're trying to survive. And they have a trauma narrative that does not speak any language. So this is why you get the fight, flight, or freeze.
So thank you. So hopefully that just provided you with a little information as to what trauma actually does to the brain. And especially when we think about youth who've experienced pre-existing trauma, right? And then they're now in this time, which we've said before is a shared trauma. We really, really want to be paying attention and looking out for them. How do we support them? How do we support each other? How do we support our colleagues? How do we support them? This is going to be the next part of our presentation. As I said, this is very brief. This is going to be the next part of our presentation, which is fostering healing and resiliency. There's trauma, but at the same time, that's not where we're going to end. We want to move into a place of healing and resiliency. How do we do that, both individually and collectively? Because that is what we need right now during this time. Next slide. Okay, so I'm just going to provide you with a couple of strategies, not a lot, as I said, for the sake of time, but please do feel free to follow up with me at the end with my contact information. Developing and supporting social emotional learning competencies with a trauma-informed lens is the pathway to healing. So, how exactly do we do this, you might be wondering. So this next section provides a very brief overview and taste of what this might look like in practice. Next slide. Okay. So now that we have a better understanding of trauma and specifically collective trauma, which we've all experiencing during this time, let's look at how we can support ourselves and each other and especially the youth that we're working with during this time. Because as I said, SEL, social emotional learning competency development and support is as important now as it was before. So in this section, I'm just gonna highlight a few really important components of trauma-informed SEL that I think are most relevant during this time. First and foremost, we know that learning happens in the context of relationships within strong communities. Now, interesting, during this time, relationships are kind of taking a shift, right? Because we're in this period of, quote, social distancing, what I like to call physical distancing, because we're not actually able to see our youth in the same way, right? We're not in person with them. We're doing Zoom calls, we're doing all types of other webinars or, you know, all types of other forms virtually to connect. But the relationship, the need for connection is still critical, does not change, and in fact is even more important for us now and is even more important for our youth. So how do we actually do that? How do we strengthen and sustain relationships and foster belonging during this time of physical distancing? There are two strategies that we can use now, but in the future. So the next two components, I'm going to provide a brief overview here, but then provide an explanation in the next two slides. So one particular competency that is very important in general, but very critical when we're talking about trauma-informed practice, is emotional awareness and emotion regulation. So if you remember earlier part of the presentation, emotion regulation, when we're in a traumatized mode, we're not able to regulate our emotions because we're in the amygdala hijack. So our emotions, our prefrontal cortex, that's offline. Emotional regulation comes with being fully in our prefrontal cortex, being able to know this is how I'm feeling and this is what I'm going to do about it. Now, young people need our help in order to do that, because they cannot do it themselves. That's not something that is innate in us. We learn emotional regulation. And I'm going to provide a strategy for helping to teach emotional regulation. Lastly, it's important to remember the importance of supporting and taking care of ourselves. So it would be remiss of me to have a trauma workshop, even this brief introduction, to not talk about taking care of ourselves. And especially now, because we are also in this shared trauma. It's not just our youth. We are also in it as well. So how do we take care of ourselves? How do we support ourselves and each other? And at the same time, maintain community. So I'm also going to be going into that as well. Okay. Next slide, please. Okay. So emotion regulation. How do we, this is just one particular strategy for how we can develop, strengthen this social emotional competency of emotion regulation with a trauma-informed lens. So one tool that we found really useful and has been proven to be effective in developing emotional regulation, both within young people and adults, are if-then plans. So some of you may have heard about this. Some of you may be even using this. I just provided just a brief visual of this here on your screen so that you can see it. This actual document will be provided for you at the end in our resource guide so that if you wanna use it, you can feel free to use it. That's totally fine. Basically with an if-then plan, we wanna identify our triggers, what we call our hotspots. We have many of these during this times of uncertainty, confusion. And if you remember, when we're triggered, we experience a flood of emotions, hormones, cortisol, the woman in the video mentioned, as well as we're in our amygdala hijack, meaning our amygdala is taking over, our prefrontal cortex is offline. How do we get back online? So when we're in this space, we can act rationally, tend to make poor decisions, which can make the situation worse and sometimes can make us feel worse. What we want to do is develop strategies that we're going to put in place so that when we're feeling triggered or a young person is feeling triggered, they're going to do something instead. So instead of their innate reaction of hitting, cursing, screaming, whatever that may be, banging something, whatever that may be, shutting down, we want to teach them that there are other alternative responses that they can have when they are feeling triggered. The trigger is not the problem. The reaction is, how do you respond to it? And that is the key to emotion regulation. So I do want to note that when we talk about if-then plans, basically we're asking youth, we're working with youth in this, we can even do this for ourselves, is listing three personal triggers. So each of us, our triggers are different, right? And for each of us, our triggers during this time may be very different. For me, I can say one of my triggers during this time is the confusion that I'm getting from the federal government. I don't know which way to go. So that is triggering. That is something that I'm aware of. Ooh, if I watch the news too much, if I pay attention to this too much, I'm gonna flip my lid. So in order for me not to do that, there's additional things that I can do. So basically with an if-then plan, we're listing three personal triggers, and then we're naming what it is that if this thing happens, right, then I will do something else. So for example, if I watch the news and I get triggered, then instead of screaming, throwing the remote, I am going to maybe take a walk, talk to my husband, do something that's going to bring me down. And that's what we want to do with our young people. I do want to note something that comes up when we talk about if-then plans is that this can only be done when we're in a place of de-escalation, when the young person is soothed, when they're de-escalating. If they're in a place of escalation, their amygdala hijack, hormones are all flooded, everything going on, this is not the time to do it, because doing something like this requires a level of emotion regulation and prefrontal cortex operation. And so in the midst of a trigger, in the midst of a situation, this is not the time to do it. The time to do it is when they're calm. Then we can go through it with them and say, let's review what happened in that situation. What happened? Let's talk about this. And this is part of a discussion, right? And we want to see if they're able to participate in this. If they're not, then we do it at another time. But, and we don't necessarily have to use this form. This is just one visual to help us through it, to guide us through it. But basically what you want to do is help them acknowledge, identify their triggers. And then what are the plans for each of their triggers? How are they going to respond to that? And as I said, we can also develop these with ourselves as well, especially during this time. Okay, next slide. Okay, so self-care. As I said in the beginning of this presentation, it would be remiss of me to talk about a trauma workshop without naming, especially during this time. I just want to name and hold space for the fact that we are all in the midst of a shared trauma. So taking care of ourselves just as much as we, you know, are there for our young people, we need to take care of ourselves. If we don't take care of ourselves, then we're not going to be able to take care of and support our young people through this time. So I just have here an example of a self-care plan. Ramapo has a self-care plan that we provide in our trauma workshops as well as some of our other workshops. This will be provided. Tin actually, you know, indicated in the chat that this is also part of our resource guide, but you just have a quick visual here that talks about it. So with the self-care plan, what we're doing is identifying the following signs and symptoms that stand out for us, right? That could be outside of work, at work. What do we notice when we're triggered, right? Some of us develop, our heart starts to pound. I know when I'm triggered, my heart starts to pound. Or, you know, that's also something that we wanna be aware of, our triggers. And then what we wanna do is we want to be able to look at, okay, how do I take care of myself? All of us have strategies, ways to take care of ourselves. We want to help our youth to find that as well, right? There are things that they could be doing to take care of themselves. We want to support them in that process. So this is just an example of a self-care plan. As I said, we do have the full if you want to use this. I know this is very brief, so please reach out to me after this if you have additional questions or if you'd like more information. Definitely feel free, would be absolutely happy to provide any more information that I can provide. Okay, next slide. Okay, so that brings us to the end of our Trauma 101 workshop and how to promote resiliency. As I said, I just gave you a taste of a couple of strategies that you can use. Hopefully you find this helpful. I just want to end and leave off with this quote, which I think is really powerful and speaks to what is happening right now and the message for us and the space that we can lean into. The paradox of trauma is that it has both the power to destroy and the power to transform and resurrect. Transform and resurrect, that's where we want to get to. Resiliency. How do we not just return to baseline? How do we return to a place and move into a place where we're even a better version of ourselves than before? That is the goal for all of us during this time. And may we lean into those opportunities for ourselves and also our young people. Okay, thank you so much.
We're gonna have an opportunity to hear from several experts in their respective fields. And we're really excited to have these panelists with us as we dive a little bit deeper into what kind of trauma entails and what we can be doing to support our youth during the pandemic. So I just want to give a little bit of an introduction for each of our four panelists. First up is Dr. Ruth Gershon. Ruth is chief psychiatrist at the New York Foundling and clinical associate professor at NYU School of Medicine, Department of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry. She's also the co-editor of Beyond PSD, Helping and Healing Teens Exposed to Trauma. And she's also an editor on Helping Kids in Crisis, Managing Psychiatric Emergencies in Children and Adolescents, both by American Psychiatric Association Publishing. Tim, is Ruth with us? Do we have her on?
Yes, she's here.
Okay.
Sorry, Ruth, I was muted. Hello.
Hi, Ruth.
I don't like my picture because I haven't gotten my haircut in a couple months and it's pretty bad. So I put
That's
it up.
Okay. No worries. Thanks, Ruth. Next, we have Cache Haffany. Cache is the program coordinator of the Mentored Internship Program at Catholic Guardian Services. To date, Cache has successfully graduated over 50 young adults in 2 years from the Mentored Internship Program. She has also recently spawned a new podcast with the youth titled The Concourse, which is hosted and produced by Youth in Foster Care. Cache currently resides in New York City with her daughter, where they do lots of New York City things, and she is currently obtaining her master's degree in youth studies from CUNY School of Professional Studies, which I think she finishes next week, right, Cache?
My first year.
Your first year. Sorry, I got ahead of myself. But the first year is good to finish, so.
That's right, yeah. Especially with all of this going on, like.
A triumph.
I can't believe I made it.
You did it.
Yeah, it's an honor to be a part of this panel and in this group and a part of this forum today. This has been truly enlightening. One of the things that I will say is that to all of my professionals in youth development, I would highly encourage you guys to encourage young adults to look and lean on each other at this time, because no one knows what they're going through like they are going through. So I definitely encourage our young adults to form a community where they can support and encourage each other. They can brainstorm as to what's going to happen next and how they're going to elevate after this pandemic.
Awesome. Thanks, Cache. Glad to have you with us. Next up is Jodessa Reimer, who is a program supervisor at Center for Family Life in Sunset Park. She holds an MSW from Hunter College School of Social Work and a BFA from North Carolina School of the Arts. She's been at Center for Family Life for 14 years and has held many roles, including dance instructor, service learning coordinator, high school advisor, and program director. But currently she oversees programming in four of Center for Life schools. She's passionate about using the arts as a tool for community building, youth leadership development, and education reform. Jodessa, do you want to just say hi real quick?
Sure. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for having me today. It's an honor to be here.
Awesome. Thanks, Jodessa. And lastly, we have Dr. Patrick Heppel with us today. Dr. Heppel is a clinical assistant professor of child and adolescent psychiatry at the NYU School of Medicine. He currently serves as the clinical director for the Bellevue Hospital ACS Mental Health Team at the Administration for Children's Services Children's Center. He is also a co-editor of an American Psychiatric Association publishing book, Beyond PTSD, Helping and Healing Teens Exposed to Trauma. Patrick, if you want to say hi real quick.
Sure, thank you for having me. I'm just very glad to see that during these times, people are still connecting, sharing, and learning. Let's keep that going.
Awesome. So thank you all for being here. If we're going to keep everyone but the panelists on mute, so if you have any questions or comments, please put them in the chat box. We have a couple of different questions related to the stories that we just read. So we'll start off with, and I'll ask this just generally to the group, and whoever wants to jump in to answer can go for it. But what's the most important thing we can do for youth like Marvin and Joanna, who bring different experiences and challenges into the pandemic?
I would say that they just have to take one day at a time and not like overwhelm themselves, and like maybe like, I don't know, do some different strategies that can help. Like they could listen to music or like draw. Like there's different things that people do to like cope what they're going through in order to like, you know, heal and then figure out, okay, what I'm gonna do next. So
that's great. I think panelists, like, what do you think about that?
I mean I definitely agree. I definitely think that this is a time where we need to help share different coping strategies to assist with the trauma that we're all experiencing at this time. Mm-hmm. I also think it's important that we keep an open door communication policy, you know, where we are, you know, it doesn't matter. My hours are now open from sunup, sundown. It's not 9 to 5. You know, if a young adult is feeling discouraged or feeling anxiety, you know, I welcome them to call me, text me, FaceTime me. To kind of try to help circumvent those negative feelings. Mm-hmm. So I know that that's something that I've been doing that's been really helpful, my staff and I. We have just been engaging youth no matter what, on the weekends, in the evening, whenever they need us, we have definitely extended ourselves to be of help and assistance in any kind of way.
Great. That's awesome, Keshe. Yeah, keeping that communication up. Ruth, did you want to add something?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I think the other piece that really resonated with me with both what the initial respondent said and also what Kashe just said is the importance of the relationships that we all have in supporting youth in this, right? That, you know, that was clear in the stories and the importance of family in those moments, both Joanna's little one and Marvin's family members that he was worried about. We may not have solutions to a lot of the things that our youth are going through any more than we have solutions to ourselves going through this, right? This is an incredibly stressful time for everybody. But just having those points of connection, those points of communication, and letting people know that even if we can't be physically together, these relationships are still strong. We're still holding our youth in mind. We're still thinking about them. And, you know, we will be there for them.
I really want to eat.
Come out the other side with them. I think that's really important. The other piece is to remember that everyone's experience is different. And all of us may be sort of tapping out our coping skills, and that's also okay, right? To just sit with how hard this is sometimes, and that, you know, I have moments where I'm exhausted and the best coping skills that I have don't work. And then I eat my chocolate and I watch my bad television and I yell at my children sometimes, you know, we all have our moments and I feel terrible about it and all that. And then I talk to friends and I talk to family and I give myself that space to be okay with not being okay. I think that's important also.
Yeah, great. Patrick?
Yeah, I was just gonna add to that. For those of us who are counselors, social workers, teachers, you know, those people, caring adults, helping youth, like, because we're all in the same storm, like I've said before, you know, it'd be easy to do a lot of like, yeah, I know what you're going through. I'm going through the same thing. Here's what I'm doing. And I think it's important to share a little bit of that, you know, to show that we're normal people as well. And listening to them and really empathizing with you know, in a sense, to hear from them, like, how is it going for them? voice clients and how they've recovered from difficult things in the past, or how they're resilient and now they're able to from the past.
Sorry, you cut out on that last sentence a little bit. Can you just repeat that last
part? Sorry. Just like, you know, making sure that not only you sit with the youth that it's really difficult right now and hearing from them, but then having them come up with their own safety plans, their care plans, their own skills, like that was mentioned by the young person over before, and looking at past times where perhaps they've had to tap into their strengths and overcome things and survive things. But actually from them, not from us, because I'm not a COVID expert. I'm not someone who's gonna, you know, come up with a vaccine. I'm also not the expert of the youth about what's helped them in the past. It's really important to empower them to tap on the strengths that they have.
Right. That's awesome. I think being able to, like, I think with the common thread that I'm hearing is like this communication or this back and forth of sharing and of sharing vulnerability to kind of get youth to understand that we're also feeling vulnerable and we're also feeling it too, and that's okay, and doing so calmly, and kind of sharing what we've been doing to kind of help ourselves during this kind of experience. Because like Cecily said, we're all kind of going through it. It's not just that the youth are just going through it. It's also us too. As far as he reveals, Marvin doesn't enter the pandemic with serious trauma he's dealing with. So for panelists, how is this pandemic itself a traumatic experience for youth like him? And what kind of behaviors might they display? Yeah, Jodessa.
Yeah, sure. I'm happy to jump in. I really liked his piece, and you know, in my little corner of the world in Sunset Park, we're trying to keep engaged with our young people as much as possible. And what we're seeing is just a lot of different waves of behaviors. So you know, in the early weeks, there was this desire to connect. There was a lot of motivation on the part of our young people to connect with us via the various platforms we were trying to connect. So through our Google Meets and Zoom meetings and on our social media or like our apps that we're using, playing chess with us and interactive chess websites. And then we've started to see a drop off, and we're starting to hear from a lot of them that they're feeling really exhausted. This is lasting way longer than the 5 weeks that the mayor initially announced. And so we're starting to see just a lot of waves of sort of like apathy, what's the point? Particularly with our middle school and high school students, we're starting to see a lot of like not keeping regular hours, having a hard time maintaining a schedule, that I know is probably the recommended thing to do, is to try and keep a routine for yourself. And even that, just the motivation to do that is hard. So, we're trying to engage our young people in, you know, we're trying to think innovatively, trying to be creative about as many different engagement sort of like touch points we can create for them. But I think that the most concerning in the recent weeks has just been sort of a drop off in communication from our young people.
Yeah. So yeah, and that feeling of exhaustion too, I think that you mentioned is part of that.
And hopelessness. It's hard to feel hopeful for them, you know, when we're in the food pantry, we're seeing them in the food pantry lines, and it's hard to find that right now, I think.
Thanks, Jodessa. Other panelists, how is the pandemic itself a traumatic experience for youth like Marvin, and what kind of behaviors might they be displaying?
One thing I was gonna share, and we spoke a little bit about this in the small groups. In Marvin's story, we see him, you know, facing uncertainties and unknowns, and like we're all facing. And often when we don't have answers to our questions and we don't have reassurance, one thing that we'll do, and someone like Marvin, who seems like a caring, sensitive, thoughtful person, what he does is he blames himself, right? Like he's responsible for perhaps spreading this to his family. And we know, again, when we don't have answers, we'll often turn to ourselves and blame ourselves. He doesn't seem to have a history of trauma, but we don't know, right? Perhaps he does. Know that youth have been traumatized in the past or been neglected. A lot of different things, right? They've been blamed for their abuse. They've been blamed for being removed. They've been blamed for a lot of different things. So that self-blame is pretty powerful for them. So it's really important for us to remind them that it's not their fault. And there are some support out there. And we're all, and in this particular case, we're probably all somewhat responsible for whatever is happening, but also for the cure and prevention and all these kind of things. So,
great. Yeah, I think that recognition of that self-blame and where it's coming from, I think is really important too. For youth like Joanna, whose pre-existing trauma will be triggered by the pandemic, what can we do to support them?
I think in cases like, well, all vulnerable youth, I think, well, what I try to always share with my young adults is that you didn't come this far just to come this far. You know, I always tell them that God gives his toughest battles to his strongest soldiers, and what they have been through, the resiliency that they have displayed is a testament as to what they can survive. So I always try to remind them that look at all that you've been through. Like, it's not over. Look how strong you are. Strong. You've been through things, traumatic situations before. You've been through, you know, maybe feeling anxiety or being depressed at times. But we get through it, and we're gonna get through it together. Like, I just really feel like it's important that as professionals we maintain a level of transparency during this time. So that we can show that you're not alone in this, and we all feel down. We all feel like hopeless at times. We don't know about our job security. We don't know about programming continuing. However, we did not come this far to only come this far. You know, just instilling like hope and faith, and just that reassurance that we're gonna get through this. We're gonna get through it. We're New Yorkers. We're resilient. We've got it. You know,
I love that, Cachet. Can you clone yourself and just be around me so like you can remind me of that? Because I feel like uplifted just hearing that, you know. And I think so do a lot of people, as we're seeing in the chat. So thank you for that.
I think one of the things that's so magical about the way you just said that, Cachet, is that you're not like dismissing how hard this is, right? I think sometimes when people try to give reassurance and try to give hope, they can end up saying it in a way of like, oh, it's gonna be fine, oh, don't worry. When you say that, you make it very clear, this is hard, this is so hard, and you can get through it, right? That, you know, it's courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is not, you know, the absence of being bothered by hard things. Courage is doing them anyway. And you're reminded
they can do it anyway.
And it's really hard, and you will be here with them to talk about how hard it is, to listen to them about how hard it is, to remind them that it is okay to fall down and still have that faith in them that they can get back up again.
Yeah, and just being honest with them, like they look to us, but we may not have the answers, but we empathize, we sympathize, and we are here to be of assistance in any kind of way that we can be. Even if it's just a resource, guiding towards a resource or making a connection to network with someone who they can put, you know, maybe, you know, have a mentor when this is all over, or, you know, just introducing them to another peer who is kind of like, you may think that they may make a good match as friends. Just doing things like that just helps. It helps. That's what I'm seeing, that it, you know, it helps. And even in just hearing that they know that I'm struggling with sleep at night, that I'm a single mom, we're all, you know, trying to adjust to this remote learning. Like, it's not just them in school, it's me at work. So just being open and encouraging just does so much for them in these times. And just giving them, you know, that's one of the things about the podcast is that, you know, I really wanted to give them a platform to be able to express themselves without any kind of like, I really don't want them to be censored in a way. I really want their authentic voice to be heard. I want them to create a sort of sense of agency, you know, within themselves, a sense of community, you know, as a team. So, yeah. things like that have been crucial to just maintaining or sustaining our relationship with our young adults.
Mm-hmm. And I want to echo what you said too about being a mom. In my experience with my little kids being out of daycare and out of school, it's, you know, when you are working and having kids, or when you're going to school and having kids, you have like a very carefully cobbled together survival. And if, you know, all of these pieces are falling down for kids, and all these pieces are falling down for us too. And I think just to acknowledge that that is really, really, really hard, and we can't do it all perfectly. You know, I was really struck in her story by how hard she's been working to be an amazing mom and to make a really good life for her little one. And that this is a setback. It's not going to keep her from doing that. We're all facing the setback in a way, you know, where it's hitting people differently, but this isn't going to mean that we're going to let all that fall apart, that we're going to continue to be there for her, to support her in having that life for herself and for her child. And if for right now, you know, her little one isn't learning in quite the right way that she wants him to, or she's not being the perfect mom that she wants to be, that's also okay.
Exactly. It's totally okay. Let this be your arrow that propels you forward when this mm-hmm. is all over, you know? Let this be an arrow.
Thank you, guys. Jodessa, I wanted to ask you to talk a little bit more about what you're seeing in a drop off in connection with youth, and what we might, and this is a question for everybody, what might we do about that? So when you're seeing that drop off happen with youth, what are some solutions to that? How can we help?
Yeah, that's like the million-dollar question, I think, for us right now. Center for Family Life is a multi-service social services agency. So any contact we can have with any family member to do a wellness check, a needs assessment, you know, there's been a lot of, you know, positive cases. Our young people have had, have been dealing with a lot of sickness in their families, a lot of death in their families. So it's really about like weaving together like support systems that support the whole family, support, you know, not just our young people, but their parents or their children, if they're young parents themselves. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think one thing that's been helpful for us and challenging for us, and we're all on a pretty steep learning curve with it, is finding just as many access points to touch base with kids. If this week a phone call is what works for you, that's what we'll do. If next week you can join us in a Zoom group and we can all connect together as well as possible, we'll try that. We are trying as many different social media platforms as possible, and sometimes just a quick sentence of them saying, "I miss you guys," is enough for us to know like, okay, they're in the world, they're connecting with us, they're reaching out. And we're trying to, you know, we have a team of folks who are checking in with the families and screening them for like benefits and services that they might be eligible for. So I think it's really important to think of like the wraparound services, but also one thing that I just wanted to say that struck me about both these young people's stories is like they had the opportunity to write these. And I think that in and of itself is really powerful. You know, I come from an arts background. I'm really passionate about access to high quality arts education for all young people, not just those who have come from privileged backgrounds. I was struck by what you were saying to Cache about the podcast, giving them a platform for their voices to be heard. So I think, you know, at Center for Family Life, we're finding as many different ways for their voices to be out in the world, for them to be expressing themselves as possible.
Great. Anything else panelists want to share? There is some questions in the chat box. I don't know if panelists want to take a look at those and see if, you know, you have time to chat back about that. But I wanted to thank you all for your time and for your communication and sharing. I think this has been a really insightful conversation and a really uplifting one. So I appreciate it. So thank you all. Okay, lastly, before we kind of wrap up, I just wanted to share some additional resources here that at Youth Communication we found to be really great. And that comes from an organization in the UK called Beacon House Therapeutic Services and Trauma Team. Tim is putting the link into the chat box. So their website is kind of chock full of helpful handouts and ways of looking at trauma in youth. But what I want to do is just share with you a couple of their handouts, just to take a look at those together, because I think they're really helpful. And I think they're part of what we've been talking about. So they have this three R's handout, which has to do with regulating, relating, and reasoning. You know, when children are in, like Cecily had said earlier, when children are in their fight, flight, or freeze mode, before we can actually, you know, sit them down and make a plan, we have to regulate. So helping them regulate and calm their responses through communication, through, you know, just talking to them, hearing them out, right? And then the second thing is relating. So relating and connecting with the child through an attuned and sensitive relationship. So finding that moment of connection and way to kind of connect. And the third thing is reasoning. So once the child has kind of calmed down, regulated, we can finally take the time to reflect, learn, remember, and articulate, and maybe do one of those self-care plans or do one of those if-then scenarios. And panelists, feel free to jump in here if there's anything that this sparks in terms of relating to your own work. But yeah, so I thought that this handout was really helpful in terms of these three R's. And also, and I'm seeing here in the chat too, that co-regulation implies teaching through modeling. And I think thinking about what are we modeling and how do we model for our young people, the behaviors and the kind of communication that we see as helpful for them. The other thing I just want to share is also the way that we talk about trauma. So where did I put this? I'll just go to the main. So this is the main resources page. And this is the, what we say comic. So shifting from traditional language to a trauma-informed language, I think is really helpful. And for some reason, it's not letting me scroll down. That's sad. But instead of saying that a child is acting aggressively, saying that they're acting appropriately, right? So they're acting in a way that's appropriate to how they're feeling, right? Instead of, you know, kind of saying that a person is angry, right, or aggressive, that they're frightened, because that's really what might be going on there. And finally, I just want to share with you the in keeping along with that, this kind of hidden iceberg idea. And this is kind of very trauma 101, or what people may think of when they think about being trauma informed, but just being aware that what you're seeing on the surface of what somebody's showing you in terms of being aggressive, distant, withdrawn, you know, oppositional, that there's a lot going on underneath that they're not necessarily showing, which can be confusion, which can be feeling worthless or scared or worried. And that we want to take the time to really get to what's underneath as opposed to necessarily reacting to what's on top. So you want to think about what is going on underneath and react to what you think is happening underneath as opposed to reacting to the anger or the aggressiveness or the confusion or the withdrawal. So that's just some things that we wanted to kind of share with you. I know that some things are coming up in the chat box. Trauma-informed language, if you take a look at that comic, it's really helpful. I'm annoyed that I can't scroll down, but hey, technical difficulties. So thank you all for being with us today and for your participation. We'd appreciate your feedback. So Tim is putting a link to a quick 2-minute evaluation in the chat box. In fact, we're going to be pummeling you with links in the chat box. So if you don't catch them, we'll be sure to include them in our follow-up email to you in a few days. We also hope that, let me just share this. We also hope that you'll join us for our next webinar on May 21st. It's an interactive virtual workshop, actually, and it's called Allies and Advocates, How to Help Teens Battle Asian American Discrimination During the Pandemic. And we'll be talking about how students can be advocates and allies for themselves and others, and how you as an adult can support your youth. And we'll read a story by one of our teen writers and get a chance to speak with her in an interview. So it should be a really great session. Tim is putting the registration link for that in the chat box. And then just some resources I'd like to share with you that we've been working on. First, Marvin and Joanna's stories were in the second issue of Inside Voices, which is a special online magazine we're publishing to feature the true stories of teens in our writing program about their experiences during the pandemic. And second, we were also publishing a newsletter of resources for ELA, English Language Arts, and Literacy educators that uses our stories in standards-based lessons. We have a special page on our website that has all these resources on it, including recordings of the previous three workshops. So you can check out our website, plus links to subscribe to Inside Voices and our ELA resource newsletter. I wanna thank our panelists so much. I wanna thank Cecily for coming in and just a lot of really great information. I really appreciate it. I feel like everybody's so creative and insightful, and it's just an honor to kind of be a part of this group today. So thank you all, and we hope to see you again in 2 weeks. Take care.